Good afternoon, everyone. I know I have spoken to a number on this call today. Obviously, our team at Grant Thornton, I lead the financial services and restructuring team. Trevor O'Sullivan and Will Stagg are members of our team, had been busy over the course of the last year supporting FS businesses in today's market with transactional opportunities, wind down planning opportunities, and levels of restructuring where that is needed as part of business opportunities going forward. I would like to start this presentation, Heather, to thank Peer-to-Peer News and our partnership with them. We found incredibly valuable to reach out with what we see as issues in the market to a wider group of peer-to-peer lenders. I know that this is an exciting time for you, and there is obviously very much still an investor, institutional investor and a retail investor opportunity here, with those two not being adequately serviced by the UK high street lending market. Obviously, there is the potential for consolidation in the peer-to-peer sector, both at a bank level and a peer level, which will be exciting to a number of you. And obviously, there is also now a well-bedded in regulatory path following the change of rules earlier in this year that most firms have adapted to and adapted to well, that we have discussed. But we thought it well worth discussing the issues that can come up and how to protect yourselves. Always good to have that within your resume where you as a firm are looking at the potential for the need for planning under that. So this is to highlight some of those issues and challenges we feel, to talk about some of the areas to adapt to them, and then, as Heather indicated, to open up to a Q&A session at the end. I thought it was just well worth, so that you understand how we are in the market, just saying that the Grant Thornton team is quite a large team. We cover responsibility in relation to in our FS team nationally, and have access to the wider UK restructuring team to support us. And many of our colleagues regionally know the peer-to-peer companies, etc. So you can see on the slide we have in front of us just that coverage in the market. If you just go to the next slide, and Heather, thank you. Equally, there is a widespread financial services dedicated team that you can tap into if you need anything. And we've made it quite a policy. Heather and I have run many colleagues on this webinar just to check in over the course of summer and see how things are going. So we put some names and faces together on this slide for you. Obviously, more than happy to take calls after this webinar on any issue that you wanted to discuss off a webinar type platform. But here you have details of some of our individuals within the team. We also have a wider FS team that we speak to, particularly for client money matters and other things that are relevant to your sector. If we just go to the next slide, Heather, thank you. So obviously our services, just very broadly, are listed on this page so that you understand where we're coming from on some of the issues that we raise. Obviously, we do a lot of transactional work up front, but a lot of our work is also done in relation to cash monitoring, to exit planning, obviously to implementation in relation to restructuring or turnaround, to exit of non-core on portfolios, and to general, you know, it's very distressed. And obviously, all on this call are aware of a couple of the unfortunate situations that have gone into insolvency. And, you know, the insight we get from being either active or able to talk to other colleagues who've dealt on that, obviously, we want to supply you with some of those insights. So I won't do more than just touch upon this side. Obviously, there are multiple services underneath this, but that's just to give you a general feel. And going forward in this presentation, Trevor and Will break the sort of slide pack between them. Obviously, we wanted to make sure that you didn't just hear one voice in this webinar. We'll all come back together to answer the Q&A at the end of the session. So Heather, I believe on the next slide, I'm passing over now.
Yep, next one. Here we are. Good afternoon. My name is Trevor O'Sullivan and I'm a partner in the FS team. So I'm just going to talk to you about what we're seeing in the market and how things have been changed over the last 8 months, you know, when we were all sitting, I'm sure many of us sat around our dinner tables, our office tables back in February, looking at what was going on in the Far East, in Wuhan, and thinking, well, that's a problem in Wuhan. It will never happen here. And look what's happened since then. It's probably going to be responsible for a lot of social and commercial change when we come to sometime in 2021, when a normality hopefully comes back. So what have we been seeing in the market over the last eight months in the peer-to-peer market and across a lot of the lending market? A lot of customers who are perfectly good customers, good businesses, having been thrown into uncertainty, and they're with their lenders having to take action, talk to them for forbearance, help them restructure, help them through this process. But in this sector, one of the consequences has been that investors have had their returns reduced. They've been restricting or withdrawing capital into the businesses, which has all caused the sector to think, draw breath, and understand what it needs to do to go forward. The government support that has brought in a completely new dynamic into the lending market, and within the peer-to-peer market, is probably going to bring some divergence between those that are able to utilize and provide the government support against those that haven't been able to. In particular, the being able to use the government support, provide the government support, has probably publicized the sector far more to the wider market than heretofore. And maybe that will bring it more into the mainstream when the world starts to normalize and companies are looking for new sources of lending. It's probably also brought governance and issues more into the fore to ensure that the companies have their governance and in place so that they can react to what's going on in the market and have an understanding of what's going on in their businesses. And it's going to probably cause a rapid evolution of business models in the peer-to-peer sector, particularly with the influx of more institutional investors, giving a more steady flow of capital going forward. Next slide. The challenges we're seeing in the market, the peer-to-peer market, and across the economy, are continuing and don't seem to be getting any easier as we continue to have local lockdowns, different levels of restrictions imposed across the country, making it very difficult for businesses to manage their way through this and plan for the future. But as we come towards the end of 2020, as government support is phased out, and that support has provided the oxygen for the economy over the last eight months, which has meant there's been very little increase in the level of company failures over the last few months, contrary to what you would expect. But the support is going to be phased out now, and as we enter 2021, that's going to cause a potential problems. As a result of all the support that has been around, a lot of companies have probably got a lot more debt than they ideally would have liked, and that will have consequences going forward, particularly as we've now see that the VAT is going to be payable over a longer period, over 11 months, and the government support loans have been extended from 6 to 10 years potentially for those that wish to to take that opportunity. However, that will leave these companies with a lot of debt for a long time. And as going forward, what will the impact of that be when they look to refinance and try to grow? Another area that's coming in December, which we haven't had heretofore for the last number of years, is the government preferential creditor status is being restored. That means the government debt for particularly POE and VAT will be rank ahead of floating charge security going forward. Now, in normal times, that probably wouldn't have been such an issue. But over the next 12 months in particular, because the government has allowed corporate companies to defer their POE and VAT going for the last few months, there has been a significant buildup in that debt. So in company failures, that debt will have a big impact on realizations to lenders in the early part, in certainly in 2021. The last area where the government has had a big impact and distortion on the economy is it's been preventing landlords from taking action for non-payment of rent. This provision has to come to an end at some point because it's unfair. Ultimately, it's unfair on landlords, and they have a business to run, and they have their own debts to repay. So when this comes to an end, it's going to have a significant impact on a vast swathe of companies, as most companies sit in and operate out of lease premises. A number of companies will have kept a reserve of cash for not paying the rent, but a large number of them will have used that cash to allow them to survive the last 8 months, and will not have the resources to pay. I think there's the Office of National Statistics has just put something out today, a survey out in the last 24 hours, where they have said that there's almost 50% of companies have less than 6 months' reserves of cash. So that impacting of landlords, again, will hit liquidity. So, and in all of this, we haven't mentioned Brexit and as to what the impact of that will be on businesses already suffering from the effects of the pandemic. With regard to investors and the retail investors who are placing money into the peer-to-peer sector, they will have seen or perceived a reduction in wealth over the past 6 to 9 months. With all the uncertainty that goes around, with a large number of them having been on furlough, and worrying about the future of their employment, they may be less willing to continue to place money into the sector, partly because of the issues that have arisen over the past few months, where out of necessity restrictions have been placed on withdrawal of capital, restrictions have been placed on the secondary market in the sale of these investments. So and then with the risks of the market, the value of assets, and people worrying about recoverability, that all may impact the ability of investors to place money into the sector. However, the appetite of institutional investors may be such that that will be where most of the funding for the sector comes from in the future. I think many firms, as we said on the slide, many firms have not been through this, a cycle such as this, a downturn in the economy, because for the last 7 or 8 years, there hasn't really been a serious downturn. Next slide. I've just said before, the government-backed loan scheme has been a boon for the general economy, and has provided the oxygen to allow companies to survive the pandemic and the uncertainty of the last 8 months, and will continue to do so. The support, anecdotally, banks are bank customers are coming back to the bank, saying those that took the loan support earlier in the cycle are now coming back saying we're looking to raise more cash because this has gone on far longer than we thought and it's been far deeper, and therefore we need further funding. And that has, and that again is a cause for concern. Many of the banks who, many organizations who have been involved in the government lending are starting to be concerned about how what the impact. Somebody's got a speaker on somewhere. Looking at the impact of the complying with the government guarantee to ensure that they, in the event that the customers default, that they will be able to claim on that guarantee. That is going to place a significant amount of pressure on businesses, on lending businesses, to understand what process is, how they're going to recover loans, how they're going to engage with customers to ensure that they're treated fairly, and to work with them to try and restructure the loans so that they can be seen to be taking every step necessary under the guarantee to allow it to happen. One of the outcomes of this may make SME outcomes of the pandemic may make the SME market more open and more to engaging with the peer-to-peer sector to provide its funding going forward, particularly if the sector has funding from institutional lenders. But what I think that taking the guarantee loans will impact and increase the costs of the sector by having to comply with a guarantee and take on additional staff to deal with the customer defaults and customer problems, which some of that cost may not be recoverable. So the next slide, please. What we're seeing so far in the market, which has been widely reported, is that the level of insolvencies are significantly down on previous year, principally due to the government support. In the year 2015 to 2019, there were between 14,000 and 17,000 company failures. In the 6 months to June, there's been only 6,000 failures. So you can see that if you analyze that, the companies are significantly down. Insolvencies are significantly down, artificially so. In September, the government insolvency service was reporting that total insolvencies were about 930 individual companies, which is almost 40% down on last year. The only insolvency process that increased was CVAs, which were up about 40%, principally due to all the retail CVAs that you've been reading about and hearing about over the summer. So in effect, what this is saying to us is that in the economy, there's a pent-up artificial demand that is keeping businesses afloat. Therefore, when these supports come to an end, it's likely that there will be a spike, a very quick spike in the level of insolvencies across the sectors. Sectors such as construction, which usually lead the number of insolvencies, are down 10% year on year. The retail is down. The sector that increased the most across the summer, as you would expect, was food and accommodation, which increased by 13% as a lot of restaurants and businesses such as that closed across the summer. So we see it going into 2021, and there will be a large impact, and therefore lenders need to be prepared and start to prepare themselves for how they're going to deal with these failures. I think I hand over to Will now.
Thanks, Trevor. Could we just move on a slide? Is the slide moving on for everyone else or? Perfect, thank you, Vanessa. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Will Stagg. I'm a director in our financial services team. So we just wanted to focus for a couple of slides on what we think platforms should be doing to protect themselves in response to the challenges and the changes to the market that Trevor's just highlighted some of. And as Trevor mentioned, when when considering these challenges, I think it's important to identify whether it's a borrower impact, it's an investor impact, or the platform. And in many cases, it will be two or three of those. The big kind of the big push, as we see it, is as platforms to step back and potentially readjust or reconsider their strategic direction. Whether that is changing the portfolio focus, where kind of historic investment areas are now facing significant distress, or for example, whether strategically there is a development need, a team building required in respect of under-resourced or under-skilled teams. So Trevor briefly alluded to banks and the additional resource requirement that they're expecting in terms of their loan monitoring teams. Despite the stats on the previous slide showing that decrease in insolvencies, with the huge amount of liquidity that's been pumped in and the government restrictions on creditor enforcement, some of the banks we're talking to are talking about doubling the size of their loan management teams in preparation for Q1 2021. And that's both in response to an increased expectation of monitoring, but also enforcement specifically. So now is a time where really we need to kind of consider a shift, consider whether the strategic direction remains appropriate. And particularly on that last point, whether the approach to borrower monitoring and engagement and potentially an increase in borrower failure and how the resource demands that may bring on the platform will be met. There's also going to be a potential increased cost associated with higher levels of due diligence and credit underwriting for taking on new investment in the new year. A couple of key areas that might be impacting strategy in the near future. We've seen some other kind of structural changes within the market, within the sector. We've seen the increase of institutional investment, some platforms offering those C bills and B bills. And this, this change of strategy in a very short time period for a number of businesses it will open up a number of questions in terms of, are the procedures in place? Is the business appropriately structured? Are there new covenants and the level of reporting and oversight that you may now be under as platforms may have changed? In addition to, kind of practical changes in terms of the physical changes COVID has put on all of us. The final comment just on that slide is in respect of data. I think in this quite rapidly changing environment we're in, the ability to understand how the portfolio is performing, to understand changes in the business and get that accurate and timely data is absolutely key. And where you might have a tech system set up for a very kind of stable ship, it might be creaking under this ever-changing environment. So it's worth reviewing that again. If we could just jump. Thank you. Against that background, it really is a great time to kind of get the house in order. Appreciate for many of us, there isn't much time in the day at the moment, but getting that governance and compliance and making sure they're working as effectively as possible in this current environment. And also to consider that legal and kind of operating model and see if that's structured appropriately and is resilient to kind of the potential failure that we see on the horizon. So we all know that peer-to-peer firms have been and will continue to be in the regulatory spotlight, particularly as an industry that, you know, is going through a lot of change and innovation, as Trevor has said, has actually got a bit more kind of public airtime as of late. And so it kind of further cements the argument that to revisit your compliance with kind of FCA requirements, and I'll come on to wind down plans in a couple of slides time. But we've just given a list of some of the areas kind of that we'd recommend, you know, looking at again and reconsidering. So whether that's ensuring your SMCR identifications and accountabilities are up to date, checking the governance and oversights arrangements, reviewing marketing and financial promotions, and that point with the next one, review investor appropriateness. I think on both of these points, you know, where we're dealing with retail, you know, either investor or borrower, there is a continued push. I mean, there are a number of articles this morning, and the FCA were on Radio 4 hammering home this treatment of financially kind of vulnerable individuals and the potential volumes of those in the UK. Their analysis was showing that 31% of adults have experienced a drop in household income during this COVID period. And, you know, the FCA are continuing to push, particularly with that retail group, you know, offering all available forbearance and help and assistance through this difficult period. So it is something that you need to think about as you consider how we're going to go through the next few months. If we could just jump on to the next slide, Vanessa. Thank you. So just on here, I don't propose to talk through this on a line by line basis, and I'm sure we'll make the slides available after the session. But we just wanted to provide some kind of considerations and challenges for your platforms, and some example questions really that might kind of drive conversations around strategy and kind of your preparedness for the future. You know, whether that's understanding the loan book and its performance, your investor kind of understanding and diversification, from a kind of financials perspective, whether they have been updated and reflect the new world, whether they assume a return to business as usual, or whether they actually, you know, scenario and sensitize out different kind of COVID outcomes, how the position is with your people at the moment in terms of their productivity and their engagement and effectiveness, whether there's a expected return to, you know, the old way back to the office, or whether there's a new norm that's been created, and whether the platform is adapted to cope for that. A lot of that will again fall on the reg side and the tech side, considering whether your kind of tech is agile enough and could be modified to accommodate change. And you know, the real practicalities of, was your real estate footprint, is it still necessary in the new norm, and is it still cost effective? So those are just a snapshot of some of the considerations that we'd recommend you consider when thinking about protecting yourself going forward. So just in terms of the wind down plan, we wanted to kind of bring this back to the forefront of people's minds, not more than a minute or two, but I guess now is the time really to dust those off and make sure they're 2020-2021 foolproof. You know, we've talked about the structuring and operational change that a lot of platforms have been through, and it is looking at those wind down plans again and saying, does this reflect the current position of our business? Are there COVID impacts that aren't, you know, short-term flash in the pan, that we expect a medium to longer term change, and therefore we need to reflect that in how that wind down plan operates? What you might find is that actually the COVID circumstances have created a new operational structure, and actually that means your wind down plan might have one strategy to it. And it might have different approaches, where there's been a move to institutional investment, or whether the CBIL and BBIL loans have gone out, which have created different legal structures or maturity profiles and kind of collection techniques in that group. So, you do need to revisit those plans to see if they're all considered and properly reflected. What you might find is that, resources that were previously shared or expected to be shared in a wind down plan now wouldn't fit that bill because of the new structuring and legal requirements. And just a reminder, as always, the FCA is focused on those plans and sees real value in them. And so having them, having them on stock, ready to share and deploy as appropriate is always a valuable tool. If you just go to the next slide. So again, on this slide and the next, what we wanted to do is just provide a list of questions really to help armor you, so that you can, you can take those away and ask yourself those questions when reconsidering that wind down plan to help, to help kind of make that an effective review. There's a consideration of financially, is your previous wind down plan still relevant? Is it still viable? Strategically, have your triggers now changed? Are there new triggers that need to be considered? There may be new stakeholders that are involved in the business now, and that may change your kind of ability to implement. It might change some of your communications, which we come on to. Your governance requirements may be more onerous for that same reason. If we could just jump to the next slide. Brill. And yeah, just to follow on a few more points in terms of comms, has any of that messaging or strategy changed? We talked about the people and the practical changes in terms of, working from home or flexible working. Has that changed your real estate footprint and your any other changes in the business in terms of kind of IT systems and structures? So all of these, there has been a rapid, significant volume of change in the sector. And so it is just a nudge and a reminder that it's really key to reflect those again in your wind down plans. So I'm just going to hand back to Trevor now, Chris, potentially in terms of restructuring options that are available.
Thank you, Will. Before, we thought it would be worth just having a quick conversation about early warning signs of borrower distress and how you might look to deal with borrowers who become into distress. As I mentioned earlier, the ONS has just released a survey of businesses around the UK, of which seems to show there's 10% are still using employees in the UK are still on the furlough scheme. 18% of businesses consider that they're at moderate risk of insolvency. And as I mentioned, 50% of businesses say they've got less than 6 months cash reserves. Now, in normal times, 6 months cash reserves would sound like a very good amount of reserves to have. However, in these uncertain times, and it could be seen that 6 months reserves could be quickly eaten through between now and the end of the year, whilst the current restrictions and uncertainties continue, leaving them with very little reserves going into 2021.
I think, Trevor, the other point on the reserves is because there is a lot of backdating for VAT and other payments, there'll be some lumpy sums in the cash flow going forward. So unless they're provided for, they will also operatively eat into reserves quite quickly.
Yeah. So in normal times, we would say that there's a lot of various different types of warning signs that you could look at across your customer base. However, I think going into the early part of 2021 and into next year, the big situation to look at is cash. How much cash do these businesses have, and what liabilities to landlords, to other creditors, have they built up in a very short space of time? As Chris mentioned, companies have been allowed to build up revenue debt. Landlords haven't been able to take any action. And so in going forward, these debts are going to crystallize at some point in the first 6 months of 2021, you would imagine. And therefore, a lot of pressure will come on to businesses from one or two aspects, to creditors. So in order to weather that storm and for the platform to understand what's going on in its businesses, all of your loan documentation will include an obligation on the customer to provide you with management information, provide you with forecasts and other information that's pertinent to that particular business that you've lent to. And probably in the last few years, there's been maybe a little bit of complacency has set in, and where with a market that's growing, economy that's growing, funding being relatively inexpensive and businesses doing well, probably not enough emphasis has been put on reviewing the management information received from customers on a monthly basis. And possibly the resources available to do that may not have been there. However, going through the next 6 to 12 months, I think this is going to become very important, so that as customers submit their financial information and forecasts, that the platform undertakes a rigorous process to review all of these this information to understand where each one of its customers sits. And that if customers are showing signs of distress, are showing signs of cash becoming constrained, then the platform can then contact the customer and take action to understand what's going on and to look at what might be a solution. And we'll talk about that in a moment. But in this way, it will also protect the platform from any issues that might ultimately have a knock-on effect into it. One of the things to look at now is to understand what sectors your borrowers are in, and whether those sectors are going to be heavily impacted going forward, particularly food, retail, leisure, pubs, bars, and any of the supply chain to those businesses. Want to go to the next slide, please? So we think, as a result of the increasing borrower stress, there's a likely that fees from lending, income from borrowers will reduce over the coming years, and also the fixed costs may increase as a requirement is needs to deal with these businesses that are in distress, which will probably be a cost to the platform rather than being able to pass on to customers. Things that if the platform starts to show signs of distress, what we would think about is engaging advisors quickly to help understand the issues and help devise solutions. Help directors understand their obligations to the creditors, and also to identify sources of funding for the platform. And at the moment, there is an appetite amongst institutional investors and funds to become involved in the sector. A number of these funds are potentially looking for ways, outlets for their funds, and partnering with a peer-to-peer is an ideal way for them to gain market share. And that may lead to a restructuring of the platform and moving away from retail-led funding to more institutional-led funding in association with potentially one or two partners. In the worst case, you would be looking at a implementing a wind down plan to ensure that the business was wound down in a solvent way and all stakeholders are protected. Now, moving on to borrower restructuring options. As was said, this is an area that has probably not received much attention over the past few years. It has not been necessary. And that is mirrored across the whole banking and lending sector. We anecdotally, and talking to some of the in some other parts of the financial sector, we're seeing significant increases across the board in teams who look after in business support and business restructuring, loan restructuring. Therefore, we see that as a potential area that will need investment and attention over the next 6 to 12 months. One of the areas we believe that if a stress is identified in your customers, that it would be start to implement is be introducing business some form of business review, which is a financial or operational review, so you understand what's going on in the business and evens the playing field when it comes to negotiating restructuring plans. In that the lender is fully informed of what's going on in the business as against being a one-sided discussion. If restructurings are not possible, we often, by getting involved early, you can work out a contingency plan to minimize the losses to the lender by maximizing recoveries, which can include looking at sale of assets, sale of the business, or possibly even putting more money in to allow the business to restructure. Going forward, there's likely to be an increase of insolvency options needed. The recent Insolvency Act has brought in what's called a moratorium, which allows small to medium-sized companies a period of breathing space prior to any insolvency to allow themselves time to put a restructuring plan to creditors. This involves the company understanding it needs time to restructure, applying to court to get it for an order to allow them to bring in the moratorium for 30 days, and they appoint an insolvency practitioner who supervises the process and acts as a moderator between the creditors and the company to ensure fairness amongst all sides. So in that situation, there is a vote, and should the creditors approve the moratorium, then the company that becomes implemented, and the company then continues to trade. A more formal version of an insolvency process similar to a moratorium is a company voluntary arrangement, which has been utilized a lot in the retail sector, but could also be utilized in a number of other sectors very successfully. Again, it involves a proposal to creditors, which sets out how the company is going to be restructured, and creditors then vote on that proposal. During this time, the company remains in the control of the directors. And if creditors of more than 75% approve the voluntary arrangement, the business continues to trade. The final, but most appropriate in corporate insolvency restructuring plan would be administration, which would also include pre-packed sales of businesses and assets, whereby businesses are marketed ahead of an insolvency and sold immediately following the appointment of the administrator. I think going forward, we will see many more of these sales happening. However, the government is also looking at the pre-pack with a view to trying to restrict the number of pre-packs which occur, where assets are sold back to the existing shareholders, directors and shareholders. They're consulting at the moment with a view to bringing in new proposals that will make that process much more difficult. And then the last thing to look at is consider the value of personal guarantees. I know a lot of businesses, a lot of peer-to-peer take personal guarantees as part of their lending packages and security packages, and also so therefore look, considering those is something that must you should do as early as possible in the process. So I think that's all for now. Open the floor to questions.
Yes, excellent. Thank you very much to Chris, Trevor and Will for your insights. We'll now open the floor to questions, which we'll begin by addressing one question that's come through. The question to the panel is, do you think retail investors have a future in peer-to-peer?
Shall I take that one?
No.
So obviously there is a significant, and all of the platforms on this call will have experienced this, a significant number of retail investors who came out of the credit crisis and the following number of years disenfranchised with the lenders and their ability to pay anything near what they would consider a good return for built up liquidity. And those retail investors still haven't got an ability to go back to an institution, i.e. high street institution, for that type of return on investment. So I do think, and I do think the FCA believes, because of the regulations that have been put in and the levels of protection that the lending, the peer-to-peer lending platforms have put in since the beginning of the year, that retail investors can still be catered and catered for well by peer-to-peer platforms, and that underlying retail investors are looking for a level of return against the opportunities that are proposed on peer-to-peer platforms, the borrowing opportunities. So I think, yes, I think they are catered for by peer-to-peers. I think they will continue to be catered for by peer-to-peers. I think what happens in 2020 needs to be the platform determining what percentage of their own investment is with retail as compared to institutional, but that is, as Will defined, more of a strategic outcome for the platform itself. But the platform provides that nimble and return on investment opportunity that retail investors can't get elsewhere.
Thank you, Chris. Does anyone have any further questions on that or commentary? Okay, if anybody would like to ask the panel any questions, I suggest please do go on mute, or off mute, sorry, and ask away.
Hi, Darren Cairns here from Lending Crowd. Thanks everyone for a good overview there. My question is slightly related to the previous one. Do you think that the cost of acquisition of retail investors is prohibitive to platforms when compared to the cost of bringing on institutional investment?
I think, Darren, if I continue, and certainly Trevor and Will may pick up as well, I think in the early days of a platform, they make a strategic decision in relation to cost of investment, because obviously you want institutional investors on the platform quite quickly. You want that spread of good return news that usually follows with a retail investor, et cetera. And a retail investor, after years of disenfranchisement, can be well pleased with what they see on a platform and the service opportunity that the platform, which is, you know, much more nimble at times than a high street, provides to them. I do think that in the cost of acquisition obviously comes the much greater focus that the FCA has had, in particular on consumer investors over the last year and 18 months. I do think, though, subject to the costs that have already been sunk by a number of the platforms on wind down planning, appropriateness tests, applying any CAS rules that are necessary, you know, looking at the 10% restriction and all the other things that came in, I'm probably in the camp that a number of colleagues in my field are, that the FCA will continue to watch on that, but they possibly won't be your biggest cost. I know from speaking to a number of people on this that are on this webinar over the course of last year, that the FCA's cost to the platform of knocking on the door to see what was happening was very frustrating for platforms. But I do think that's going to be less going forward, and therefore cost of acquisition is more around marketing. It's more around keeping OPEX and service levels, and communications definitely very key and on spot. And as long as that's embedded for the platform, I do think there is still a return you can make on a retail customer, a retail. Will, Trevor, I don't know if you want to add.
I think that's right. I think it's going to be more strategic for the platform as to whether it wants to have retail investors or whether it wants the flow of capital from institutional investors, which may be more consistent and may allow it to fund more different types and larger projects.
Yeah, and I think where that infrastructure already exists, and you know, it's been happening for a number of years, it makes that much more viable than a circumstance where you're setting up from fresh with that retail market.
Darren, that answers your question.
Thank you.
Right, we'll open the floor again for any more questions. We have about 6 minutes left.
Heather, while we're waiting for questions, I did receive a couple of questions earlier on. One of them related, and Trevor did touch quite widely on the government loan schemes in the peer-to-peer sector, and whether we think that this will have a long-lasting positive or negative impact to the industry. And I do think that it's worth touching upon that and touching on a little market news where we have as a firm, particularly in relation to the BBL schemes. In relation to the positive and negative, there certainly was a raised profile for the peer-to-peer industry, and they've had, I think, a very good relationship on return on investment and service levels with borrowers, as the banks haven't serviced them well. So I think that has necessitated that positive shift that was seen earlier in retail investors. So I think, that I would have to say is certainly a very positive impact. Will there be a negative impact with these loan schemes? I can certainly say that, in our view, will be down to how the platform and the investor are sort of joined at the hip in relation to, and obviously this is not all platforms, so it doesn't affect all on this call, but how they're joined at the hip in relation to recovery. And just back to my point about market intel, we are seeing now as a firm from the high street banks who have done most of that government scheme lending, that they are considering not taking in hundreds of FTEs to lead the recovery themselves, but they are thinking of outsourcing and looking at doing the outsourcing metric for that role, even though we're all aware it would be a recovery in 2020, now to take the strain off their own balance sheet. So those who may be involved in B loans and are considering, what they do strategically for their platform, I know will be considering that aspect as well. And I do think from a retail investor point, I do think that those people who are retail investors into the high street lenders themselves, considering what might happen in some of those B loans, will be ruining the day of government loan schemes being put in place. So it is all about the ability to ensure recovery level without damage to the underlying, in the platform's case, retail or institutional investor, and in the bank's case, likely shareholder.
Okay, thank you, Chris. We have 3 minutes left, so I think another question's come through. I think we can squeeze one more in. And that is, do you expect to see consolidation within the peer-to-peer sector?
Will, would you like to take that?
You're on mute, Will.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's an interesting question. I think it comes back to the comments earlier around strategic direction. And obviously the platforms in this call, there's a huge kind of variety of actual strategic direction amongst the group. I think I'd, rather than the word consolidation, I'd probably comment more in respect of, you know, the eagerness of funds out there to acquire and grow and develop some existing platforms. And so, you know, perhaps consolidation will come from that perspective in terms of this kind of more commonality in the types of investors or owners as such. I'm not sure if Chris or Trevor have any other views.
I have also, and you're all aware of, you know, the market input in relation to particular platform and Metro Bank, but we have heard of other banks being extremely interested and sounding out platforms, and particularly some of the platforms where they've had an initial investment in as well, because it is a unique opportunity for some of the more institutions who are less driven by a platform that's quite nimble, quick on service, and therefore them being able to partner, acquire, etc. Over and above, as Will said, that the potential for platforms to acquire platforms is a unique opportunity that I do think we'll at least see some level of take up on. Why wouldn't you? They have allowed platforms to grow, and many platforms have done exceedingly well, and so they should. And on that basis, there's an opportunity there for a lender to take up that service level that's in the platform, add institutional investment, and possibly early growth, expanded growth to the platform because of the funding. And so I do think there's potential for both, you know, existing platforms consolidation, as well as alternate lender, i.e. bank or PE fund type consolidation.
Okay, great. And it's now 2 o'clock, so the end of the session. Unfortunately, we can't take any more questions, but if you do have more, please don't hesitate to get in contact with us. Vanessa, if I could ask you to flick to the next slide. These are your presenters today. Please do feel free to get in touch with us with any questions you might have, or go via Susie from Peer-to-Peer Finance News. Thank you again all for your time today, and thank you to the speakers for an excellent presentation. I hope you all have a good afternoon.
Thank you, everyone.